This is a recording of the advice given by Her Holiness Mataji Nirmala Devi at London to the London Sahaja Yogis on 11th November 1979.
Sahaja means meat, Sahaja means born. So something that is born with you, that is innately built in you, which sprouts by itself, which manifests itself. Like you can see a seed sprouting into a tree.
This is what is Sahaja. Now all other yogas which go along with it are part and parcel of Sahaja Yoga. They cannot be separated from this to that. I think people are under misunderstanding. There are four limbs of one yoga or something like that. Even that won't be a misunderstanding as to think that they are separated or different. When we say that we have eaten this food, it doesn't mean like a bolt, it has gone inside in the body and just passed out of the body like a bolt coming out, does it? It means that you have tasted the food in your mouth. It means that it has secreted some saliva in the mouth. Later on in the late, it has passed through the trachea of the other places, or like you can call, what do you call, esophagus, going down into the stomach part, and then to the intestines, and then to the larger intestines. All this movement or passage and all that is done through the other kind of movement which is existing in the organs itself, like the stomach itself pushing it down, coming from your brain, the sympathetic and the parasympathetic coming into play. And working it out, it's a big system and organization that is working out. Now if you want to separate it, that digestive system is different, respiratory system is this different, and your heart system is different, or some other brain system is different, or nervous system is different. I mean, you can't take it out like that, a brain hanging on one side and your digestive system hanging on the other. It is one integrated form of organization, which is a living organization, which understands each other, which reacts to the demand. You cannot separate these systems. But as it is, our brains are so disintegrated, or they are good at that, disintegrating everything within us and without, that we want to disintegrate the living thing, which is yoga. Yoga is not a dead organization. It's a living process. Absolutely a living process. When it is a living process, you cannot do anything about it, so it is Sahaja. At the most, you can little bit shift it here and there and push it around and all that. If a tree is coming up, like in Japan, they want to give it a shape, then they'll cut one branch first and bend it a little more, then cut another one, then bend it this way, that way, and give it a shape. But whatever is living is working out spontaneously within us with many complicated organizations which are living themselves and are aware of what they are doing. For example, your body is much more aware of me than your rationalities. Say you are a possessed person. You won't accept that you are possessed. You won't accept. I won't say myself also, because I don't want to get any kind of thing which is in stock there, you see. I know human beings. that if you tell them something like that, you can be out for any sort of trouble, you see. So, I don't tell you. But the body knows me. When you come before me, the whole body shakes, just like that. Makam, isn't true or not, tell me. Because it is a living body, it knows me. It's not a dead body. So whatever is living is so well looked after, organized, and in a living way which we do not understand. Because we deal with the dead. Supposing I have to start this instrument, then I know there must be a cord, I have to put it to that means and that it works out. And I always say, Sahaja Yoga is like that, you just take out your cord and put to the means. I say like that. But do you think it is that simple? Do you believe that? That you just pull out the kundalini from there and put to the mains? No, it is not. When the sprouting of the kundalini starts, when the awakening starts, it passes through various centers. How? How will you explain a kundalini which is at the base end of your spinal cord rising upward? Now, if I tell you that this is even more than your digestive system, that the kundalini which is an energy, as we call it, is the one that thinks, understands and loves you and knows each and everything about you in this life and life before. If she is so capable and if she knows everything and she is an entity by itself, and if she has to come up to your head, is it easy? It is the most difficult thing. If you have a stone lying somewhere, you can pick it up and throw it wherever you like, isn't it? Very simple. Even if there's a little worm, it knows how to get out of the way of a big bull coming round to save itself. And a bull, if it sits anywhere, impossible to raise it. You try your level best. We have some very drastic methods for that in India. You have to burn some chilies, red chilies, and put that smoke into the nose of a bull like that. Then only the bull would rise. Otherwise you try anything, it won't rise. It would be sitting and settling itself nicely on the ground. So you come across such bulls also. Sometimes it happens like that. But to make this kundalini which thinks, understands, is an individual mother of an individual which has been born with you all the time, who knows all about you and who loves you the most, and she is the one who is going to give you your realization, your birth, second birth, so she is your mother. This kind of a kundalini that exists within us must be the most difficult person to rise. Has to be. That's why people say kundalini raising is very difficult, is correct. So one has to find out the methods of how to make the bull rise. Because this Kundalini is absolute dharma, is absolute righteousness, absolute purity, ideal most personality that you could think of, which doesn't tolerate any nonsense, falsehood, untruth, anything like that. She is Nirmala, you can call her. She is pure. She is purity personified. She doesn't accept any nonsense, no compromise. She is within you. See how beautiful you are. She is not afraid of anyone. She cannot be enticed, enchanted, or tempted by anything. And she loves. But her love is that pure that nothing is higher for her than her own love. She never reconciles to anything. And she's the one who is going to give you your self-realization. So for human beings who know about it, they have to find out methods of pleasing her. What makes her so unhappy? Why doesn't she want to rise? They have to find out the means and methods. And the result of that probing has brought forth other yogas, which we call as Raj Yoga. Or they call it as Hatha Yoga. What is the third one you call it?
Kriya.
What? Kriya Yoga. I think Kriya and Raj is the same, about the same style it is.
But they are Bhakti Yoga. Gyan
and Yoga. Bhakti Yoga. And Jnana Yoga. And Karma Yoga. All these are the methods human beings want to employ to make the bull rise. I mean, they get frustrated, they want to hang themselves by the nearest tree. So that also is another frustrated yoga. Then sadistic yogas, then beating yogas, then beating other yogas. Then it goes on like that, you see, flowering into better and better things. Then fanaticism. Because human beings find it difficult to sit still. You see, they get a challenge. Oh, this bull doesn't rise. All right, I'll make it rise. Moreover, they haven't got the authority. Even those who are self-realized, they have no knowledge. Because Kundalini is not made by them. Like, even if I get this machinery, I don't know how to handle, how to use it, I may try it, but I may burn my hands instead. So such a hodgepodge of endeavor brings forth so many yogas in this world. And everybody is baffled at it, that how is it there are so many yogas, whether we should do this yoga or that yoga or Buddha or Mahavira or Christ or this and that, and what is it? Then church yoga, voodoos, and what's wrong in witchcraft, the other day somebody said. Nothing wrong. But the bull will be settled down better. It won't rise then with voodoo. Now, so they have to try to find out, what should we do now? Stand on your heads. Bull won't rise. No, it won't. Break your necks. It won't. So what should we do? So, we should know what is a Kundalini that is within us. all these yogas that have come out have been depicted from the experiences of people. Because some people, when they try to raise the Kundalini, so-called, say they started jumping. So they said, let us jump and the Kundalini will rise. Then some people started taking out their clothes, maybe, some sort of a funny thing like that. They felt heated up. So people thought, let us take out our clothes and we'll find God. Some people felt some sort of a grip on the stomach. Or some of them did see also these things happening within. So they called it a mulabandha. They said the bandha has taken place. Something has gripped there. So the Kriya Yoga is that you take out your tongue from here. I mean, you cut this thread of the tongue, all right? And you push it back. Here. Touch this tip of the tongue here. Normally they are wagging with that, it goes on. Push it back here. At the Vishuddhi center. They think Vishuddhi is here. You see, the problem is they think the Vishuddhi is here. So they push back here. And they think that they will achieve the raising of the Kundalini by tickling this portion. It is just the other way around we are trying, you see. The effect cannot reach the cause. You have to go to the root of the cause to come to the effect. Do you see my point? Supposing the Vishuddhi chakra, which is here, a very subtle center behind, is spoilt. Then the effects are felt, say here, and your tongue gets affected, your eyes get affected, your nose get affected, your cheeks get affected, the 16, you see, all these things can be affected. But by tickling your nose, you do not touch your Vishuddhi chakra, isn't it? Do you see my point? For example, something goes wrong at the center from there where the electricity is coming here. By tickling this here, you cannot cure that one there. You have to go to the roots. Or on a tree, you find a fruit. Is getting rotten. All the fruits are getting rotten. So by treating the fruit, can you treat the disease? You will have to go to the roots. So these people, when they saw all these things happening to human beings, they formed different types of methods. All are wrong and all are right. Try to understand. It's very simple. After realization, all of them are right. Before realization, all of them are wrong. Before your car starts, if you start turning the brake or using the wheel, you are spoiling the car. When the car has started and you know how to drive and you have become a master of driving, then everything is right. Otherwise, the same car which has to drive you from my house to this ashram will land me up somewhere. In the same way, the same thing which power realization has no meaning. After realization only you start understanding. So let us take the case of Hatha Yoga. It's based on centers, no doubt. It is based on Ishvara Pranidhana, no doubt. All the Ashtangas, all the eight sides of Hatha Yoga. See, from human point of view, I'm saying. For them, why Hatha Yoga came into being is first that they should fix their attention on the Ishvara Pranidhana. Means they must fix their attention into the existence of God. Not blind faith, but to understand that there is God, so that you humble down yourself. Then you should go to a realized soul as a guru. Guru means a realized soul, minimum. Any dictum and Hari becomes a guru is a nonsense, absolute. He has to be realized soul, and if he's a realized soul, he'll say like that. He doesn't talk of separation, he talks of authority because he's there. He has that authority. Those who talk of separation, crying and weeping and woes and all that, are blind like all others. They have no business to lead you. There's no humility about it. I mean, if I have a red shawl, I should say I have a red shawl. What is there to feel humble about it? I mean, whatever you are, there's no harm in saying what you are. When you are not that, when you do not have that and you say that, it is arrogance. But when you are there, you have to say, that's why Christ said, I am the light, I am the path. I mean, he was not trying to be arrogant about it. What is there to feel bad about it? So, Hatha Yoga itself is done under a person who is a realized soul, not only realized, but who knows, who has mastered the art of Shaktipat, is the raising of the Kundalini. Minimum. Of course, Sahaja Yogi just raise it like that. It's different, but not any other yogis can do that. It's only you, because you are authorized, that you just raise the Kundalini just like this. So what these Hatha Yogis have done is that boiled it down to only physical sense. So you have to have Ishvara Pranidhana, Yama Niyama. That too before 25 years of age you have to discipline yourself in a way that you should understand what is right and what is wrong. Now those who have done all the wrongs of the world before they are 15 years of age, now at the age of 25 they are trying to learn what is Yama and Niyama. How can you do it? Tell me now. Supposing you have spoiled the car completely, at the most you can ask for insurance, if you have paid for it. But how do you expect the car to come out absolutely factory, from the factory as if it's absolutely new? A horse which is being completely mutilated cannot run a race, isn't it? That would be maddening. So, one has to understand that these Yamaniyamas and all these things are not meant for us. At least for the Western people. In any way, let us accept it. Whatever it is, in experimentation or whatever it is, we have committed lots of mistakes, or maybe that we have been experimenting. Again, I'll say the same word. Whatever we have done a lot of harm to ourselves, to our body, to our mind, because we had nobody to guide us. All right. We didn't want to harm ourselves, but by mistake it has happened now. What to do? It's a very sad affair. People are sick. They cannot do hot yoga. The atmosphere is sick. The whole place is sick. They want love. They don't want exercise. They don't want scouts. They want somebody to love them, to heal them, to cure them, to establish them. There is no word of love in Hatha Yoga these days, because you pay for it. One thing you cannot pay for is your love, isn't it? How can you pay for love? And that's why this modern Hatha Yoga is just a misnomer. But after realization, you can use Hatha Yoga because you are purified. You are cleansed, you are healed, your wounds are all right. People are wounded, they are so much hurt. They are extremely unhappy. You touch them and you feel it. Why talk about big things when they don't even have energy to sustain themselves? It's a strain on them. And none of them are realized souls, nor they are masters in Shaktipat. So that's why it was said that you should go to a guru who is a realized soul, go into jungles, 25 years of age you should be there, and practice under his guidance in complete celibacy, with the atmosphere of complete celibacy. Now, come to Kriya Yoga. When we take to Kriya Yoga, you see, taking out the tongue, as I said, we are cutting out, putting it back into the thing here to tickle the Vishuddhi Chakra. I mean, I don't know, sometimes your rationalities also go off, I think. By doing anything like that, do you think you can excite this great power within you, which is discrimination, which understands each and everything? You cannot befool her by that. So, all these tricks that we have been trying with ourselves, of poking yourself here and poking yourself there, you are just spoiling your instrument for nothing at all. But it happens when the Kundalini rises through the Vishuddhi Chakra. That when the dilatation of the chakra takes place, it happens that your tongue is pulled inside. It happens that your eyes get dilated. I hope they do not put atropine to dilate their eyes to get the Kundalini awakening. So it happens like that. Khechari takes place. The bandhas take place. The stomach holds the Kundalini with a bandha. It closes down the chakras. When the Kundalini comes up, it closes itself down automatically, so that the energy is kept upward. It should not be allowed to fall down. All these things happen within us. These bandhas happen, which some supraconscious people might be seeing, and they want to think that if you pull your stomach like this, put your tongue inside, these things happen as a result of Kundalini awakening. But by doing these things, you do not awaken the Kundalini. Now, did you follow my point? Did you? It's clear now. And that's why these Kriya Yogas have started. Even the jumping has started. Even the nudity has started. All these things as a result of some people who are trying to raise the Kundalini. Even in the center when it rises, all these things happen. But when your health is not all right, you are sick, your heart is working, laboring very hard to look after your physical being, you try to make it even weaker by taking to these strenuous things. And by using the other way round method, as I told you, you also spoil your instrument. Like the electricity has to come in it. So the electricity must flow from there. If I start blowing from here or poking from here, with frustration also breaking this one here, the electricity is not going to come. Only this will be finished. Do you follow my clear-cut idea? It's very clear-cut that if you try to spoil your own instrument, you are not going to get the energy to rise within you. But if he was a realized soul, then he would tell you. First of all, he may raise your Kundalini, minimum awaken your Kundalini, and ask you to make way for the Kundalini to rise gradually. Human beings, when they raise the Kundalini, they raise it by every chakra. They bring the Kundalini, say, Muladhara, of course they cannot touch. So the Kundalini will come up to, say, Nabhi. At the most. Then how to retain it there? So they will say, eat less, do not take away your attention too much. You must eat very little food, so that there is not much attention on the food. Keep yourself detached. This is before 25 years of age. Do not starve too much. Eat at regular intervals. Don't have much attention anywhere outside. So that attention is kept there and the Kundalini doesn't drop down. From the little bit an inch progress it has made in 25 years. They are born again and again and they move at the pace of a little ant, you know. And they fix your Kundalini by nails there. And they say, don't lead any adharmic life. You have to lead a very righteous life, like a horse, you see. When you have to train the horse, you have to put these two blinds around. So they have to train the horse, you see, before it really starts running the race. But with this is important, the most important is the love of the grandparents who are with them, in those days used to be, to look after the children, and the love of the Guru and the training and discipline of his own self. The Gurus who take money from you, what are they going to train you up in? Business management? Or dubious methods? Or cheating? Their own lives are so beautifully blend with their love and their knowledge and their whole understanding that it has a direct effect on the character and the personality of the people. Like now in India, nobody can write an epic like Ramas. We don't have any Ramas there. We won't have perhaps. Nobody writes, they write only stories. Now the poems have started coming out of India. Like your, who was this lord you had here, horrible one?
Byron.
Byron. Now Mr. Byron is born in India, I think. He's left your country. So like that. So all the dynamism in literature is also finished because there is no ideal before them. They cannot think of a perfect personality. So the epics are different in the same way. When we go to learn these things, we see our gurus, so-called, we see their lives. The impression that we have within us is also just the same. And they cannot teach anything unless and until they themselves have the light. Now this Kriya Yoga is also the same thing. It is described by great saints in India that these Jalandhar Yoga and all these Jalandhar Bandhas and all these bandhas take place, means the bondage takes place in the stomach, in the heart, and all these granthis are broken and all these things are described. Yes, it happens in you also when the kundalini rises. It does happen. Because I am quite a big master. I do it everything myself. I don't leave anything to you. Till you have got it. Only thing what you have to do is to be absolutely freely choosing the path of self-realization. That's the only thing you have to do, to be absolutely free. In all your freedom you have to accept Sahaja Yoga. And if I find that you have not chosen it by your freedom, you get out of it very fast. You won't be there. Yourself will run away. If not, I'll see to it that you run away. So, one has to understand that all these margas, all these paths, even like bhakti, I've told you that three types of bhaktas, or the ones who are asking for kamarthis are there. So many have come to me for secures, so many of them. That's a good thing, that's a good chance for me. Then they get cured, then they have that love. Then they are mumukshus and they can become very great Sahaja Yogis. In India there are many who have become like that. They just came for the treatment and they became great Sahaja Yogis. So they can pass through all these various stages. So one has to understand that this is the time of Mahayoga, where all this Antaryoga, means all these happening inside, takes place automatically. I have something to do with your Kundalini, very much. And she knows me very well. So much so, as soon as she sees me, she's up there. So happy. And the first impact is so great. You feel it, yes, you've got it. She rises with such a thumping joy. You get it. But again you go back to your crutches. Even you have lost all your troubles and everything is finished now, still you want to have your crutches because you are identified with them. So you go back to your crutches and also want to again become lame. It's just acting going on for some time. But when you act for a long period, then you become lame. Because you have been playing games, you see. And now the game is over. So you have to accept yourself that you are great and that you have got it now within yourself. It is there. Now you are a light. You have to accept that you are a light now. You are not the same as you were before and you are transformed into this flower. you should have faith in yourself and confidence in you. Because you have been so far identified with people like that, with bad experiences, indifferent experiences, you do not want to believe that there could be an experience of that kind, you do not want to accept it. But if you little bit understand it, go smoothly with it, you will settle down with it nicely. And I am here to make you the master of it. Absolutely the complete mastery over all this. When this Mahayoga comes in, you don't have to worry about anything else. All the yogas are at your feet. You just raise your hands just like this and the Kundalini will rise. It's a fact. You just try. Anybody is sick, you just put your hand like this and the person is going to be alright. Try yourself. This is Mahayoga, it's the culmination point of Sahaja Yoga. Once you achieve it, then you don't have to do anything else, then you become that. Because only everything works for the becoming, and if there's something that just gives you the whole thing, then why should you do it? All the things that have happened to you after coming to Sahaja Yoga, I'm going to give you the list of those. And what are they called in Sanskrit language? Thousands of years people had to work to get it. But you have got it just like that. It's a fact. It's difficult to accept this, that you have got it just like that without doing any head or leg or any exercises, isn't it? But just wait and see what you have got. Of course, some people don't get it because there's a problem. Some problem is there. Doesn't matter. It will work out. But those who get it should know that you have got, because of something. And that's something you have to discover. That's what you have to find out for yourself. There is a reason why you got it like that. Like mantras also, you see. Somebody told me that there's a guru who gives mantras according to the age. It's all nonsense. Complete nonsense it is with age. You see, even a realized soul would not give you a mantra. That's why it was regarded as a great thing if somebody would give you a mantra. Now every Dick, Tom and Harry like a donkey brays in your ears and you think it's a very big mantra, I won't tell you anything what mantra I've got. They are trying to befool you, they don't know, they are befooling themselves. Whatever they have done, they'll have to pay very heavily. So mantras are never given just like that. You have to know various points of a person as to what is your kula daivata, the worship of your family, what is your personal worshipping God, what is your horoscope, what are the stars you are catching. At this point, giving of the mantra time is to be determined at a particular time of the horoscope. What is the time of the horoscope that tallies with the guru's horoscope also? That's why you must know that people used to have hardly one or two people, even a person like Gyaneshwara, gave a name to one person in his lifetime. Here these Dick, Tom and Harrys are giving to people just like distributing I don't know what. Nothing is easily available more than these names of horrible things which have no meaning. But if I told these Indians, they will know. In loko ek mantra diya ainga, ek diya hai thinga. Nahin, in loko. Maharshi yogi ne, ab tumko to malum hai matlab. At your command, you can coin your own mantra. Because you have some sort of an authority which you can use. And every mantra that you will say will be awakened. You know that. After realization, it is such a wonderful thing to see that even if you are not yet out of your possessions, still you work it out. Still nothing happens to your kundalini raising system or nothing happens to that, still you can raise the kundalini for that, isn't it? Still you can give realization to people. You may be possessed this side, fighting with the spirit that side. But here with one hand you are raising the kundalini automatically. There the lots of these spirits trying to possess you. With one hand you are killing them that side and from one hand you are raising the kundalini. And nothing would go wrong with the person whose kundalini you are raising. To that purity it is. Otherwise to give mantra and to take mantra, a person has to starve for 7 days. Not to see a man's face or a woman's face. All sorts of vidhis are there. Then only you can get it. Yeah, some people tell the guru, disciples to wash their hands 108 times every day. All sorts of these neti kriyas and all that has to be done before a mantra is given. It's a big ritual. Why? Because you are so vulnerable. It's like phosphorus. And you cannot put phosphorus into somebody's hand. You have to make all arrangements till you put it. But supposing you become all powerful, then what? Everything becomes a child's. Everything is so simple. You are raising the kundalini, you know that there are centers, you can raise the centers, you know how to awaken them. That is why it is Mahayoga. It had to be this way, sometimes. Otherwise how are we going to save this world? How this creation is going to be justified? We have to find out. I mean, God had to find out some method by which you, all of you who are seeking Him, are to be blessed. And that He should be manifested so that His work should be completed. So this is Mahayoga, which encompasses all the yogas. There is no need now to go to Stone Ages to come back to human stage. It is something like that. Or else you can say, if I have to go to India, I need not go like Columbus and end up in America. Somebody who knows the way has come to you, who knows everything, all about you. Somebody who has done all this, who knows all tricks of the trade, and also knows you very well, though still I'm learning quite a lot. About human beings I'll have to still learn, I think. So many things, you know, they can be quite queer. You don't know why they behave like this. You just can't. Suddenly you find, oh God, what's it? It's a great revelation sometimes, the way you see human beings, you know, the way they behave. Very interesting. Very interesting. Very interesting creatures, I must say. I mean, they never behave the same way. You cannot predict. Most unpredictable. Don't know what they'll come out with. Very interesting. After Sahaja Yoga, you will also enjoy very much. Feeling tired. All right, go ahead and sit on that thing. She's poor thing tired. No, sit down. Sit down. Go and sit there. You can sit on a chair. Hmm? All right, take it easy. Take it easy. Come on, sit up. No, you must be tired. Mm. It's difficult for you to sit on the ground, all of you. Mm. Come. Come, come, come. Mm, come. This is all about so many yogas I've told you. And if you have any questions, now ask me questions, but sensible ones. Again, I say, ask me questions, because I've told you in a very short way, but later on I'll give you a complete idea. Now, let's see this one. Now, this Lama business is all wrong, I must tell you very frankly, my child. And it has brought about lots of problems, all right, for you. Now, everybody has got it, you haven't got it, as you see. So, still little problem, doesn't matter. You have to little bit cooperate with me and you are going to get it. Huh? You must get it, is my desire. And if that is your desire also, we meet on the same point. Better now, is she? Better, she is improving. But the Swadhisthana is very much down. They do some tricks to spoil this instrument. Hypnotize, all kinds of things. Now, Kundalini is the desire of God within you. Is not desire for God, is the desire of God itself within you. So it can be only awakened by that desire, isn't it, itself? It is the desire of God within you that is being placed. And the desire of God is the Shakti. And the desire of God is that He loves you. His desire is to give you all His powers, all His bounties, and all His loving capacity. This is His desire, which is placed within you and is dormant. So when it rises, His desire is fulfilled in you. And that's how you get your fulfillment. Unless and until you are God, you cannot command desire of God. But after realization, He gives you, bestows His power, that you can maneuver His desire. You can raise the Kundalini in other people, which is the desire of God. And you can make Him desire. That is the greatest one can achieve, isn't it?